get upstairs.
I am upstairs, dummy. Third floor?
Go.
You know, Kevin, I had an idea.
It's scary up there.
Don't be silly. Fuller will be up there in a while.
I don't want to sleep with Fuller. You know about him. He wets the bed. He'll pee all over me. I just know it.
Fine. We'll put him somewhere else.
I'm sorry.
It's too late. Get upstairs.
Everyone in this family hates me.
Well, maybe you should ask Santa for a new family.
I don't want a new family. I don't want any family. Families suck.
Just stay up there. I don't want to see you again for the rest of the night.
And I don't want to see you again for the rest of my life. And I don't want to see anybody else either.
I hope you don't mean that. You'd feel pretty sad if you woke up tomorrow and didn't have a family.
No, I wouldn't.
Then say it again and maybe it'll happen.
I hope I never see any of you jerks again.
I guess you're not alone after all.
I just want to serve my country, be the best fighter pilot in the Navy, sir!
And you can't stop Maverick, you can only hope to contain him.
That's good!
We're reading a very different script all of a sudden on the prompter. I feel like there's some sort of secret message given to me to give to Gino that was somehow a threat. Well done! I mean, no. I want this the rest.
Oh my God, so itchy.
Nice backdrop, guys. I love it. Hi, Kevin. Where is he? This way. Even this little kid, I kind of find obnoxious. I looked at Joe and I saw her future. Maybe she'll even be a blonde, but that haircut, minivan, wood paneling, four yammering kids in the back. Take it all in, Joe. That's what it's going to be like.
I had a bob in college. I've had my hair short before.
Yeah, I don't think you've ever had a Kevin McAllister short. That was a great wig. That was a great job.
Thank you.
I've always maintained your best roles were as little boys. And I did barely any prep work at all to play a sexless 80s era soccer mom.
I got the milk, eggs, and the fabric softener.
Do you remember that line? He says it's so weird.
He says every line weird.
I got the milk, eggs, and the fabric softener.
I love the fact that we both watched it last night.
Yeah.
Talk about over-preparing. Although, I'll use this stupid plug for Getting the Sacred Cow. I'm going to just eviscerate Home Alone. So killing two birds with one stone here today.
Before you get into your whole quiz that you think I'm going to fail at.
Oh, you will.
Okay.
I do.
Watching these movies back, you're not really supposed to analyze it, but maybe you can use this as ammo for your Gutting the Sacred Cow. But we're watching it, and I realize, sure, as a kid, that neighbor felt creepy, right?
Yes.
He's supposed to. There's all these rumors going on about him. But really, he's just a shitty adult. Because how many times does he run into Kevin alone around town, and at no point is this neighbor like,
I'm using that. That's
where cool. Are your parents? The fact that this kid comes to church alone, there's a problem there.
I will see you the church scene and raise you this. Obviously, as we know in the beginning, just by having brains and being people, that this guy's going to come into play probably at the end, redemption wise. Not only does he save Kevin from the wet bandits who are quite literally about to kill him,
yeah.
Just sort of like, well, here you go. And
he's like, let's get you cops. Home.
Yes, but a home without parents is very clear at that point.
Also, that toothbrush shoplifting scene.
Yes.
When Kevin gets scared and runs away, that neighbor could have easily said, I'll pay the $2. Let's not have the cops chase after him. Uh-oh. Let me buy my neighbor kid who has no parents with him. A $2 toothbrush.
As one who grew up in that area, very close, I will tell you that all suburbanites outside of Chicago are assholes. So there you go.
Oh, well.
Yeah. That's the other thing about John Hughes movies, even though he only wrote this one. They all have this sort of nostalgic sheen over all things suburbia.
Mm.
And that is very, it's all, you know what it is? Every single one of them is all what John Hughes wanted the suburbs to be.
Sure.
Rather than what they are.
Well, isn't
I don't think that movies do that today. They're a little more, they want to show what's going on behind the curtain.
Yeah, it's never reality.
Yeah.
It's always some version of it.
Look, I think they're observations. Other people are like, they're obvious, Bill, and you're a moron. But I choose to focus on the people that don't say that. The mute. Any other takeaways from the film? It's fresh in your head.
Yeah.
There's a weird Christ figure thing going on with the guy, because first he has a gaping wound in his hand. Then when he meets Kevin at the church, he has a Band-Aid over his stigmata.
Oh.
And he's almost like reverse Christ. By the end, when he's waving to Kevin, there's no more wound, period. That's got to symbolize something. First thing that goes to your head is old man's also Christ.
Fascinating.
But I don't know what it is.
We will all be saved by Jesus if we remember the true meaning of Christmas.
I'll tell you, almost as much, if not more so, than the penis Christmas special, really push the Christianity aspect of Christmas.
Oh, yeah. Well, and the fact that Harry and Marv won't go into a church. They know Kevin has run, possibly escaped into the church. They're like, I'm not going in there. And he's like, I'm certainly not going in there.
I forgot about that. Not to mention, weird that in a bunch of statues in a major scene, there's one actual cane and one actual robe that Kevin can hide in and blend in with baby Jesus.
That makes a little more sense to me. You got to keep a blanket there for baby Jesus. The other really strange moment was at the beginning of the film when it's Harry, right, is the bald one.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's
Marv is tall. Okay. Harry is the cop, right? Dressed as a cop, standing in the front of the house, trying to talk to anyone. No one is like, holy shit, why are the cops here?
Right.
What the fuck happened? Is everything okay? Why is there a police officer standing at the front? Everyone's like, fuck you, my parents don't live here. And then they keep walking. And even the McAllister parents, they're like, hi, what can we do for you? Sorry, we're a little busy. We're leaving town. Do you want some eggnog?
Yeah, even the
people. Very strange.
Yeah, there are a lot of people aren't acting the way they should in this flick. Any thoughts, boys, that I could steal and use of Getting the Sacred Cow? As far as all things, you must have seen Home Alone. Don't pull this diehard shit with me, Conti, you fucking hater of America.
No, I've seen it. I love that movie.
You know what? I wanted to hate it more for the purposes of the show, but I got to tell you, it's not like the number three comedy of all time great. I'll tell you that much right now.
No, I wouldn't say that, but it's hard to hate because it's just a fun, easy to watch movie. There's not much to it.
Yeah, well, it's background music.
And fucking, I love Joe Pesci so much.
Yeah.
Especially in that movie.
Eats up the screen.
All the slapstick, all the fucking,
That's going to be one of my arguments. It's like, you're either a Three Stooges dude or you're not. Fucking hate the Three Stooges. Mm-hmm. Anything that involves a lot of physical violence, I know it's slapstick, I know it's not supposed to be real, more cartoony, takes me right out of it. I don't like it. Like, the scene where his foot goes slowly into the nail.
Yeah, that one you feel.
I'm out. Maybe it's because I've had many a tetanus shot when I was a kid, but fuck that noise. Bobby, yay, nay, on Macaulay?
Nice.
Nay.
Oh, okay. Why?
I think John Mulaney summed it up best. In the sequel, he gets lost in New York. It's a grid system.
Yeah, maybe lost in the village, but you have to be really small so you don't see the skyscrapers.
Yeah, he's staying at the plaza. Like, literally, the park is your east to west.
I mentioned this on a tweet about Christmas Vacation. I know you like that movie.
Yeah.
Really hard to empathize with these guys. Kevin is not just upper middle class. Dude's fucking loaded.
Oh,
that credit card got him a penthouse suite at the plaza in the sequel. That house, I think, was just sold for like $20 million or something. He is absolutely fucking loaded.
Yeah, I mean,
and Clark, the big thing in Christmas Vacation is he's worried that his Christmas bonus won't be enough to get his family a pool. That's what you're pulling for throughout the entire movie. That's what you feel bad for him for.
Everyone has a dream and maybe a little reno project they want to do. It makes it super relatable.
You guys didn't have a pool.
We did not have a pool growing up. We were not upper middle class. We were middle class.
And again, if you've got scoliosis, you're going to sink like an anchor. Every mom knows this.
Yeah.
The back
Immediately after Home Alone, speaking of the slapstick physical comedy, we watched on YouTube. We wanted to look up the stunt guys who did all of the bits. And what I always find so fascinating is that so many of these movies that do so well started on a shoestring budget. but it's also like, fuck you for not paying for more, like in the budget. Like, just do a slightly bigger budget. I'm sure
million,
you can find the money. But these stunt guys were just falling. They were just falling on these fake frozen steps.
Ugh.
You know, doing flips off of the stairs when they slip. All of this stuff was just them landing hard.
Okay, I'm going to send this to, I'll send it to both Bobby and Steve. You can keep talking. I took a video.
It's like, what am I seeing behind me? There's a fire.
It's just an hour-long video of Joe Pesci with his head on fire from that scene in Home Alone.
That's okay, great. So it's like the Yule log, but different. Wait, is it the scream for an hour? And that's incredible.
It's the Yule log. It's like white noise after a while, you're right. Well, as always, when we do these amazing make movie betters, that's what we call them now, huh?
Yes.
I got a little no such thing skis. I encourage everyone here to play. I'm going to tell Bobby to go last because he's, I believe, in control with the video answers. So, you know, if he takes a peeksy, it won't count either way because he'll go last. But let's go to the fun no such thing skis graphic. They didn't have the budget or the name brand behind them because John Hughes just wrote the flick. To get someone like John Hughes, but they sent John Hughes an early, not John Hughes, I'm sorry, John Williams. They sent John Williams an early plant. Loved the movie so much that even though he was doing stuff like your Star Wars, your Raiders, your ETs, like, well, do the soundtrack for the movie.
The soundtrack is so good. Delightful. It is one of those films where when you hear the music, you immediately know the film.
Yes, but not a good earworm. If I've got Raiders or Star Wars in my head, fine. But the bum 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 bum
it's like slightly menacing. It's nice.
If you're getting old, kill yourself. If you get to my age, the earworms are horrific, and that was a okay. Let's stop. Okay, question one. In an interview with People to mark the 30th anniversary of Home Alone 2, which of the following stars admitted that they were actually injured while filming one of the many slapstick-fueled scenes in the first film? A. Joe Pesci. B. Daniel Stern. C. Catherine O'Hara, who I so amazingly just portrayed. Or D. the father, John Hurt. Joe, we'll go to you first.
Yeah, wasn't it Joe Pesci? I feel like I read something recently where he actually did burn a part of his body.
All right, we've got one for Joe Pesci. Yeah. Steve, who does seem to get a chuckle from that scene.
Yeah, I think it was Joe Pesci. I think I know the exact scene he got hurt in.
Two for Joe Pesci. Bobby?
I'm going to go with Catherine O'Hara.
Thanks, buddy. Fuck. Let's go back to the endless Joe Pesci getting burned, yes. Just came out recently that he actually really burned his head badly at that. Why are they using real fire? So let's see. This is the bonus tie bit breaker question. Ready? This is not multiple choice. You're just going to have to guess. We'll go around. In fact, you know what? Whoever yells out the correct one first wins. How about that? And then we'll release the video answer. Which famous SNL alum tried out for but didn't get the role in Santa in this very scene? So we'll play the scene and then you guys try to guess, okay? So here's the scene. Whenever the scene's over,
we'll hear. I know you're not the real Santa Claus.
What makes you say that? Just out of curiosity.
Just out of curiosity.
Do you want us to wait or just yell out whenever? Right.
You get the idea of the scene. So five, four, three, two.
Shoot.
SNL alum.
I don't know any.
Farley.
Bobby wins.
Do you need the phone number?
Who's Farley? Came to the audition drunk and harassed one of the casting directors sexually, and they decided to go with this nameless fella that never really made it after this. But that would have been Chris Farley's first movie.
I liked this guy.
He came, been out on an all-night bender. Very sad. Who knows? If he'd gotten this role, maybe everything would have changed for him.
Wow.
Yeah, I don't even know if he... I guess he was on Sarah Lennon, I'm not sure.
I don't know. I'm happy that this guy gets residuals every year.
Oh, God, tell me about it. Can you imagine? All you need to do is be in one of these holiday movies, guarantee money at a time of the year when you really need it. Every year in perpetuity for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
God damn it. I fucking hate everything. Why did this shit... Why am I the one who didn't even play the game? Why am I the miserable one at all of this? Well, I think that's pretty much it, unless you guys got any final thoughts. I will say this is just another reminder of how bad the fashion was for women in the 80s.
Oh, my God!
Can you imagine?
time it took us to play my stupid game, Steve gets his final Christmas wish.
Wow. That looks so good.
I want that Yule log. I don't want.
Although it looks like you're kind of enjoying it in that one. Well, you're like, really
cool. It was one of those, you know, -5 Illinois days, and he was just enjoying the heat. Hey. Yeah, Steve's kind of going,
I did see, I guess it was a TikTok, who knows anymore.
Really?
But someone said, maybe it was a tweet, that Home Alone really isn't a Christmas movie. It just happens at Christmas.
Yeah, well, you could say that about any movie.
But I totally disagree, because there are so many Christmas elements in it.
The whole point was to rob the buildings when people were out on Christmas vacation.
Yes.
With all their ill-gotten
stuff. And the fact that he thinks he wishes his family away, so he asks Santa to bring his family back. It's the only present he wants.
Mm-hmm.
The going into the church, meeting his neighbor there. Like, there is a lot of Christmas element. All of the music, like...
Again, one of the few Christmas movies with a Christian bent, which I don't really like. I'm kind of done with the whole Christmas. Oh, I hope I miss church this year.
Wait, one more thing that I really hate. When he, Douglas and I figured this out. He leaves the church. It's chimed 8 p.m. He runs home and he has an hour to set all of that up.
Yeah.
And it begins, the montage begins with him unrolling his plan. Did he also draw that plan within the hour? And then he makes his microwave dinner, sits down at 8:58, awful time management.
Yeah.
And then the clock chimes, and he doesn't even take one bite of his microwave macaroni and cheese, like not one bite. That was the most unbelievable part.
Take the girl out of mukbang, right?
I want to see one bite.